A Philippine patrol aircraft continues to face dangerous situations while conducting operations in the West Philippine Sea. Michael Delizo tells us China's been using flares to harass a Bureau of Fisheries plane.
A Philippine patrol aircraft faced danger anew while conducting a maritime domain awareness near Bajo de Masinloc, also known as Panatag Shoal. After a Chinese fighter fired multiple flares, the Chinese aircraft deployed its flares approximately 15 meters from the Cessna 208 Grand Caravan aircraft of the Philippine Fisheries Bureau on Monday. Flares are used as a countermeasure against an incoming missile. The Chinese aircraft further put the BFAR plane at risk when it conducted dangerous maneuvers. This is the second time the Chinese side harassed a Philippine government aircraft. On Thursday, China launched flares from its military base in Zamora or Subi Reef. The target was the same BFAR aircraft, which at the time was monitoring and intercepting poachers at the Calayan Island Group inside Philippine waters. China's actions could have caused the fisheries plane to crash if the flares were sucked into the turbine propeller engine. According to a wires report, the Chinese Foreign Ministry said it took countermeasures against the Philippine aircraft due to supposed trespassing. But the Armed Forces of the Philippines rejects China's claims, saying Manila's patrol operations within Philippine territory are in line with international law.
We will not be deterred to perform our missions, not just on the air then, but on the sea. So regular natin itong ginagawa, continuous ito.
But the Philippines is holding off deploying fighter jets in the West Philippine Sea to avoid escalating tensions.
If you are to use fighter jets, I think you have a different intention for that one. What we are doing here is our rightful maritime patrol within our exclusive economic zone. I think that the intent is very clear on our part that we do not intend to any escalation on our part.
Similar to previous incidents, the Philippines called on China to cease provocation and dangerous actions that threaten the country's legitimate activities and the right of all vessels and aircraft in freedom of navigation and overflight in the South China Sea. Senator Jingo Estrada also expressed concern and condemned China's use of flares. He called on the international community to join the Philippines in holding China accountable for its reckless actions. The AFP said it has already submitted a report to appropriate agencies, including the Department of Foreign Affairs, regarding the incidents of air harassment by China. Meantime, U.S. Ambassador to the Philippines Mary Kay Carlson says her country stands firmly with Manila in condemning China's use of flares against a Philippine aircraft. Carlson also called on Beijing to cease its provocative actions that undermine a free and open Indo-Pacific region. Michael Delizo, ABS-CBN News.
Still on China's harassment in disputed waters, about 20 Chinese maritime militia vessels surrounded a Bureau of Fisheries ship while distributing fuel and food packs to Filipino fishermen at Iroquois Reef on Saturday morning. A People's Liberation Army Navy vessel said or was also spotted some 4 nautical miles from the BRP Romapenet. Now, local fishermen hope the Philippine government can find ways to prevent Chinese boats from loitering in the area so they can freely move around. The BFAR is looking to deliver provisions to 11 so-called mother boats carrying 300 fishermen.
Mas maganda, sir. Mas gusto namin yan.
Bakit?
Eh, siyempre, lagi kami nakakita dito mga nabal natin o mga katropa.
Parang kakamping.
Oo. Ibig sabihin, hindi na kami kaalangan sa mag-ikot-ikot kahit saan.
A 50-year-old man dies during Saturday's early morning raid on the compound of the Kingdom of Jesus Christ. Thousands of police troops are still searching the 30-hectare property to serve the warrants of arrest against the group's leader, Apollo Kibuloy, and 4 other members. We'll bring you this report later in the newscast. In the meantime, Philippine authorities suspect the ousted mayor of Bamban, Tarlac is headed to a known crime hub in Southeast Asia after supposedly fleeing the country last month. Katrina Domingo reports.
After country hopping around Southeast Asia since mid-July, dismissed Bamban Mayor Alice Goh's final destination could be the Golden Triangle. That was what the Presidential Anti-Organized Crime Commission revealed days after the former mayor's sister, Sheila Goh, and their associate, Cassandra Lee Ong, were nabbed and repatriated to the Philippines from Indonesia. The Golden Triangle is a mountainous region across Laos. Myanmar, and Thailand. It is notorious for being the hub of syndicates and triads involved in narcotics and other illegal activities, with their operations extending to other parts of Southeast Asia.
We're confident that she's trying to get into the Golden Triangle because the family, the Guwu family, has business interests, gambling interests in Cambodia. They're part of a big criminal organization. Yung Fujian Gang, kung saan kabilang itong mga Guwu, ay kabahagi at kapartner nung Golden Triangle Triad.
When asked if it would be impossible for the Philippine government to bring Guo back to the Philippines once she reaches the Golden Triangle,
so we have to prevent that from happening. What complicates the investigation is that hindi ho limited dito sa mga taong ito. May mga nakikita kami mga koneksyon doon sa mas malalang mga criminal organization, the Triad.
PAOK's investigation show that Guo is still staying in Batam, one of Indonesia's transportation hubs.
She will definitely not go to China because she's accused of a serious crime in the Philippines in relation to illegal gambling.
The PAOK is now calling for an investigation in all law enforcement agencies to identify those involved in Guo's getaway, as there are no records of her departure from any airport or seaport in the Philippines. Guo was last seen in the Philippines on July 14. She was staying in a private resort in the western part of Luzon. But before authorities could reach the area, Guo was allegedly seen boarding a speedboat and sailing away from her supposed hideout. After 3 days, Indonesian immigration authorities tracked her departing from Bali via a plane.
Napakatanga naman namin lahat sa law enforcement. Kami lahat. At hindi namin siya nabantayan at nakita, no? So someone somewhere dropped the ball. We have to accept the fact that corruption is seeping into some agencies of government. Nakakalusot ang mga ito because of money.
Malacanang earlier ordered the cancellation of Guo's passport, but the PAOK cautioned against this move, saying that it might be more difficult for the Philippines to bring back Guo once she loses her passport and her Filipino citizenship. Kasha explains Guo's Chinese citizenship will not be automatically restored should the Philippines cancel her passport. This means that Guo may be declared as a refugee that can get protection under the United Nations.
They will become stateless individuals. I hate it to happen. I hate it if they would become refugees and they would fall under the framework of the United Nations Commission for Refugees, because they would take on a different legal character and they would be protected by that legal character.
Under international law, stateless persons may not be forced to leave the country where they fled to.
Pag naging stateless po yan, ang laking problema natin yan. So let us be cautious in canceling the passport.
Sheila Goh and Cassandra Lee Ong are still under the National Bureau of Investigation's custody, but they are expected to be turned over to the Senate and the House of Representatives in the coming days. Despite these developments, the PAOK believes that Goh is not a criminal mastermind, but is just a small fry in the world of international syndicates.
The Philippine Coast Guard is set to file an administrative case against the owner of the Mirola 1, which ran aground in Bataan Province. The PCG says they have summoned to the ship's owner, Mary Jane Ubaldo, for a hearing. Mirola 1 is currently moored at a shipyard in Mariveles, Bataan. The ship leaked oil after it ran aground on July 23. It left the port of Navotas without clearance from the Coast Guard.
Napaligiran na po natin ito ng oil spill boom just for containment purposes at for any expectation na do wala na po itong ano do wala na po itong oil or langis sa loob, it is also part of our security measures para hindi po basta-basta makakaalis yung ating yung barkong yan.
On another distressed ship, the Coast Guard reports steady progress in removing oil from sunken tanker Terra Nova in Bataan. On Friday, the salvor company Harbor Star was able to siphon off over 178,000 liters of oil from its cargo. If the weather holds, authorities say they expect to complete the process in 2 weeks. Meantime, the PCG says they continue to coordinate with local government units to assist communities affected by the oil spill. Terra Nova was loaded with 1.4 million liters of industrial fuel when it capsized near Limay Town in Bataan during rough weather on July 25.
We are in close coordination with the local government units encompassing the municipalities and provinces along Manila Bay. We have this ICARE campaign plan, this intensified community assistance, awareness, response, and enforcement, in which the Philippine Coast Guard is going through the local government units and getting in touch with the coastal communities.
The Philippine authorities are determined to comb through the 30-hectare property of the Kingdom of Jesus Christ. Police officials are convinced the group's leader, Apollo Kibuloy, and four other members are hiding inside the sprawling compound. Ernel Tokmo reports.
Over 2,000 policemen marched from Camp Quintin Merecido to the compound of Kingdom of Jesus Christ just beside the Davao Airport before 4 Saturday morning. Most are wearing riot gear while others were carrying long firearms. The police force came from Davao region and neighboring regions within Mindanao. Their mission, serve the warrants of arrest against the group's leader, fugitive Apollo Kibuloy, and four other members. The respondents are facing charges of child abuse at a Davao City Court and human trafficking charges filed in a Pasig City Court. Davao Police Regional Office Director Brigadier General Nicolas Torre III faced off with the legal counsel of KOJC, Attorney Israelito Torion. The lawyer questioned the legality of serving the warrant of arrest.
Ito, Attorney.
Yes, sir.
Hindi ito ang lugar para tayo magdebate.
Yes, sir.
Kung may reklamo ka, maghahay ka na lang ng reklamo. Pero ngayon, papasok kami sa ayon sa gusto mo. Okay?
Ipaalam ko lang po sa ayon. Sige, ano sabihin? Sir, ganito po, may certification po ang NBI, sir.
Immaterial yan, attorney.
Na-serve na daw yung alias warrant.
Immaterial yan, attorney.
The PNP only gave KOJC 30 minutes to open their gate, or police will forcibly enter the KOJC premises. Some members express dismay because some of the cops have already entered at the back of the compound.
It would be under protest, sir. It would not be a consented search, sir.
A man who guarded the compound overnight died of cardiac arrest. KOJC members and the media were not allowed inside, but the search operations can be seen in real time through a LED screen. The policemen entered buildings and structures, including several offices and a school. Emotions were high as police swarmed inside the compound. The PNP is convinced Kibuloy is inside the compound.
We are not terrorists. We are peace-loving people.
According to the group, the PNP has searched some 22 structures.
Basta, nagka-disagree kami kasi ang stand namin, more than 8 hours na sila, dapat yung arrest warrant tapos na. Eh, meron pa daw siyang isa na isang area daw na kailangang puntahan. Pero may ongoing kaming usapan ngayon, parang i-hold muna niya pending na meron kaming usapan na ginagawa.
The PNP, however, said they will not stop searching every corner of the compound until they find the subjects of the arrest warrants. Police officials are appealing to the followers to let them do their jobs.
Trabaho lang po, walang personalan, walang halong politika. Kung sinasabi ni Kibuloy na siya ay inosente, di patunayan po niya doon sa korte. Marami naman po siyang mga magagaling na mga abogado. Sa ngayon po, sa second phase na po tayo, may mga na-identify na mga areas sa loob ng compound na gagamitin natin yung radar or katong yung alive detection device. Malalaman natin through the heartbeat.
Hernal Tokmo, ABS-CBN News.
Teachers in Pagasa Island hope for more classrooms and teachers amid the new school year. However, convincing other teachers to come in would be difficult due to tensions in the disputed waters. Job Manahan tells us more.
Good morning!
Teacher Kathleen teaches under the shade of the tree for her students here in Pagasa Island. For Kathleen, this is the better option rather than to share a room with another class. According to the officer in charge at Pag-asa Integrated School, the island already has 4 classrooms for around 100 students compared to just 1 classroom last year. There are also 13 teachers from kindergarten to junior high school.
Parang naiyak ako na
yung dati from konti, tapos ngayon palaki na ng palaki, elementary, high school, at finally may senior high na kami. Kasi bilang teacher na ikaw ang tumagal dito, masaya ka na nakikita mo yung school na lumalaki, di ba?
Rialyn said she is proud of their achievements despite the challenges. Meanwhile, some hired teachers from mainland Palawan could not go to the island due to fear of harassment or aggression from Chinese vessels while traveling.
Nahihirapan kami magpadala. Kahit minsan may teacher pa kami na hindi nakaakyat kasi nandun pa sa mainland, hindi siya makasakay. Kasi nga, limited lang din yung slot, saka yung parang yung mga Navy vessel, hindi na sila gaano masasakay ng sibyan. Gawa nga, natakot sila, baka mamaya magkaroon ng aberya.
Among those who went to Pag-asa Island to teach is Kathleen Acosta. She says convincing other teachers to go there could be difficult because travel is limited to riding government ships or planes.
Travel pa lang po, grabe, 3 days na po kaagad sa lansya yung travel namin. Travel pa lang, parang ang hirap na po. Doon sabay, mararanasan mo na hindi ka maliligo. Then syempre po sir, ang kahilo po doon sa lansya, minsan hindi na makakain, higa na lang siya. So yun. Then the rest naman, okay naman po. Sa travel lang po talaga medyo hassle siya.
She adds, teachers in Pag-asa need projectors and laptops to aid in teaching the students. In a text message to ABS-CBN News, Education Secretary Sonny Angara said he would look into the concerns of the teachers in Pag-asa Island. Meanwhile, Pag-asa Island's coordinator said the construction of a 2-story school facility is already underway.
Nag-improve, di ba? From wala pang school, and then meron ng school. And then yun nga, naragdagan ng mga magang bata. Di ba? Ang konti lang ng dati, parang ilan lang yung dati, nag-umpisa 2014 ata, 13, ilan lang. Tapos ngayon, ang dami na nila, 111 na. So, ang saya din, nakakaano din dahil meron pala mga bata talaga na mga magulang din o mga nag-interested na mag-stay dito at dito paaralan yung mga anak.
From Pag-asa Island, Job Manahan, ABS-CBN News.
A state of calamity is eyed in Iloilo City due to the dengue situation there. Mayor Jerry Trañas on Saturday said the city still has 47 active infections out of the 872 cases this year. Authorities also recorded 4 deaths. Trañas said the calamity declaration would allow access to additional funds to purchase more misting machines. The wider Iloilo province earlier this week was placed under state of calamity. Mayor Jerry Trañas vows more proactive measures by the LGU to curb dengue cases in the city, but he also called for greater participation from the community.
We are already preparing the different actions that we are going to take. Once there is already a state of calamity and we will be able to use some of our calamity funds. It is very important that we work hand in hand with the community and with the mass media because this is not going to go away. We need the community action so that we will be able to eradicate the mosquitoes.
National Anti-Poverty Commission supports the planned review of government's poverty threshold. The National Economic and Development Authority earlier drew flak for its claims Filipinos who spend above 64 pesos for their meals are not considered food poor. MAPSI says participation of representatives from basic sectors, including farmers and urban poor, is necessary in the review of the poverty metrics. NEDA has assured the public the Marcos administration is determined to address the root causes of poverty following the decline in poverty rates last year. Some passengers at the country's main gateway get a bad start to their trip after the airport's cooling system bogged down. Fortunately, airport authorities were able to fix the issue on Saturday. This and other long weekend exodus updates from Andrea Taguines.
Over
overseas Filipino worker Antonina spent Friday night at the Ninoy Aquino International Airport all hot and sweaty while waiting for her flight to Kuwait. By noontime on Saturday, she was still using a plastic folder to cool herself.
Mas nakakapagpahinga ka pa kasi ang haba ng oras ng pag-aantay mo, hindi ka makatulog. Ipapaypay ka talaga.
But other parts of Terminal 3 were lucky.
Sa ngayon po bumalik naman na siya ngayon. Okay naman na po yung condition na po. Normal naman na siya.
The Manila International Airport Authority apologizes to passengers who had to endure the heat while waiting for their flights because of maintenance work that had to be done on one of the chillers at Terminal 3. The MIAA said the repairs started on Thursday and were completed by 6:30 Friday night. However, it expects the temperature in the whole terminal to return to normal this Saturday.
Nakita nila na isang chiller ay hindi 100% na nagbibigay ng efficiency. Sabi ko, subukan yung bilisan, ayusin niya agad kasi mahahaba yung ating bakasyon, no? And we were anticipating na may mga magbibiyahe.
The MIAA had just finished upgrading the cooling towers of Terminal 3 in July, which cost nearly 200 million pesos. It clarified that it was a chiller and not those towers that caused the problem.
The six cooling towers that were repaired are already working. I'm still working now.
Adding to the stress of passengers is the long line at immigration counters. But MIAA General Manager Eric Ines said this can't be avoided given the huge volume of travelers this long weekend. On Friday alone, the number of passengers in NAIA reached more than 137,000.
Dapat nakaya na talaga yung area. If you remember, na-design yung mga yan way back kung design for 35 million passengers per year. Ay umaabot na tayo ng 42 million.
San Miguel Corporation, which leads the consortium that's slated to take over airport operations in September, earlier said that it will prioritize fixing NAIA's air conditioning system and expanding the main gateway's overall capacity. Over at the Parañaque Integrated Terminal Exchange, foot traffic has declined. The PITX management believes most travelers already left these past 2 days. Meanwhile, the Philippine Ports Authority said, as of 6 a.m. on Saturday, more than 22,000 Filipinos traveled by sea for the long weekend. Provincial ports such as in Negros Oriental, Bohol, and Panay Guimaras saw the most passengers, while travelers at the Manila North Port are getting fewer and fewer. Andrea Taguines, ABS-CBN News.
A big-time oil price rollback seen next week. Estimates show diesel may be cut the biggest of up to 2 pesos per liter. Gasoline could also drop as much as 1 peso and 30 centavos. As for kerosene, prices could decrease by up to 1 peso and 90 centavos.